Good to see everybody here today. Glad to come out to the Lord's house. Hot, sunny summer day. Looking forward to this coming week. Pray you had a good past week. When school start? How far are we away from school? 2 weeks? All the parents are like 13 days, 4 hours, 6 minutes. So, something like that. But anyway, glad to have you. Glad you came out to the Lord's house today. It's my prayer that as we come in, you'll be blessed by reading God's word. And maybe something I have to say may help you throughout this week. Our announcements this week, don't forget VBS. Do we have any VBS meetings today, next week? Yeah, Miss Amy has hurt her shoulder, and she won't be able to be a transporter for the 5th and 6th grade. It's the person that takes the kids from one spot to the other spot, make sure they go to their places. We can't even depend on them to get to one spot to the next now. Anyway, so take one spot to the next spot. Give them a whipping at each spot, they'll get there. Yeah. No, we give them each spot, but we need somebody to lead that, 5th and 6th grade. If somebody could take them, get with Miss Cheryl and be that. Also, we're going to have a mission project that night at that week during Vacation Bible School. We're going to redo a back porch for one of our ladies in church. It's local. It's about 2 or 3 miles from here, so it's real close. So if some of the men can come, maybe 3 or 4, 10, you know, we don't need 10. There's going to be an adult Sunday school class. If you want to go to class, that's great. But if there's a couple men that want to help out with the back steps and some things like that. Got some rod and some things we need to tear out and put back. But if you'd like to help with that week after next, that'd be good. We'll go over and do that. Any other announcements? Any prayer requests? Remember Miss Carrie Hodges. Also remember Miss Debbie Parker. She's going into surgery right now, I think, is what I was told. So remember her. She fell and broke her hip part that was amputated. She's having a hard time. Remember Miss Debbie. Any others? Any others? Good to see you, Brother Tracy. Brother Tracy's back with us. It's good to see him. Half of him's back anyway. Amen. It's good to see you, brother. Remember Daddy? Still having some, trying to get back from that surgery, so he's still down. Any others?
Sarah Lee.
Sarah Lee? Yes, sir? Remember Brother Pete? Remember Jack and Rita Howell? Any others?
Philip Harper?
Yes. Any unspoken this morning? Amen. Yes, ma'am.
My brother is going to have treatments for 6 weeks.
6 weeks. Tell me his name again.
Ricky.
Ricky. Any others? Amen. Well, let's pray and we'll get ready for church today. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for today, for your goodness that we've seen this week. God, I just pray that as we come into your house, Lord, that we lay all the cares of the world down. We set everything aside, come into your house, Lord, ready to worship you. Thank you, for God, for the folks that are here today that are ready to hear your word and sing songs of praise. God, I pray that, Lord, their needs will be met, their hearts will be gladdened, God, and people will be glad to be in your house today. Help us, Lord, to cooperate with praise and to cooperate with listening and be enthusiastic about being part of the services today, because we're here for you, God, not the other way around. I just pray, Lord, that we honor you, Lord, in everything that we do here today, for the songs that are sung, for the preached word. We pray for all these prayer requests, Lord. Lord, as we bring them to you, knowing, God, that we need you in days like this, God, and folks are in tough places, and I pray you'll bless those. We pray for the brokenhearted today, Lord, those that are having hard days and, Lord, just tough times. I pray, God, you'll bless them today. Give us strength, Lord, and give us patience and give us kindness to show to a world that needs it. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would, please stand. Visit around just for...
Let's worship the Lord together this morning. I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and there's not a place Your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing.
In our lungs, so we pour out our praise. kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come again this morning, Lord, just thanking you for the beauty of the day, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we can come together and sing songs of praise and lift up your holy name, Lord. We just pray for the preaching and the word that Brother Ray is going to bring in just a few minutes, Lord. When we come to this part of the service, we give back a small portion of what you've blessed us with in the way of the tithe and the offering. We just pray that you would bless it and bless the giver, Lord. I pray that we would use it wisely in the way that you would see fit, Lord. And we'll honor and glorify your name through it all in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
What's up, Silas? It's good when the children mimic us because they're going to, you know, all the time, good or bad. Good or bad. Amen. What a blessing. Take your Bibles with me. Turn to Genesis chapter 22. Genesis chapter 22. It's a place that's very common. It's been preached out of. Genesis chapter 2 verse 1. Been preached out of. I can't tell you how many times over the years I've visited this place. There's so many lessons to draw from this examination of Abraham. There's such a lot to glean. Usually in the past, I start preaching in this area or start preaching about this, and there's so many rabbits to chase. There's so much to do, so I'm gonna try to stick to it, because once I kind of get an idea on something, I if I'm not careful, I will stray away. But I'm gonna try to stick to it if God allows me to. If He takes me away, I'll be glad to go. I had a whole nother sermon in mind today, all the way through this morning, and I'm gonna wait till next week to preach that. That's somebody here today needs this, undoubtedly, because I don't doubt that God is in control and I hear from Him. So it's important. It's important that everybody gets in God's way, gets in the way, finds herself in God's way. You know, I think about people like Zacchaeus. You know, if he'd have went three streets over and climbed up a tree, he never would have met Jesus. But he looked and seen where Jesus was going and got in the way. That's how he met. That's how he knew if he could just get to the spot, he'd meet with Jesus. Because Jesus, you know, God tracks a straight line. There's no variance, no surprises. It's always the same. And this morning, you may be here and you think that you're going through some tests, trials and temptations. We've heard that our whole life in church, trials and temptations. You know, at some point in your life, you should come to know the difference between the two of those. Yeah. There's a difference between trials and temptations. Yep. A lot of folks lump them together, and they say, well, these trials and temptations from God. No. God tries or tests us. The devil tempts us. You got to be careful to know who's who and who's doing what. And a lot of times, if you're not careful, you'll be mad at the wrong one. Amen? And here's the thing. You know what a test is good for? A test is good for telling you where you are. How about that? How many of you young people like taking tests? No? Anybody? I got a paper the other day to keep some of my licenses good, and it was a flyer that we can do our stuff online. That's awesome. I don't have to go there to school. We have to go every year. In crafts, you have to go every year. So I'm thankful I don't have to go. I can just go online and listen to this guy. And in big, bold writing on the yellow hard stock copy they send in the mail, it says, "There is no test." I'm for that one. Listen, I'll pay an extra $100. I'm for that one. Nobody likes taking tests. Nobody. I mean, when it's all said and done, nobody really likes saying, well, you know what? I wish we'd have a test today. I can remember going into Miss Betty Johnson's class. Anybody have Miss Betty Johnson's? Miss Betty Johnson grew up. She was one of our teachers in Folkestone. And she'd come in. She was never in the classroom when we got there. You ever notice that, Jeffrey? She'd always come in the classroom with her glasses in one hand, some papers in this hand, and she's holding her glasses up in the air. She'd say, "First question, and you better be ready." Because every single day, there was a quiz. And quizzes, you know, had a way of, so for some of you kids here, you like this. Some of the quizzes was for like testing you for little things, like, what'd you learn that the day before or the day before? But a test was like, it was a big thing. It was like, oh, well, what'd you learn over the semester or the whole week or maybe whole year? Kids take more tests today than I've ever seen in my life. Amen. We'd have a couple of tests in 9 weeks. And listen, if you were a dummy, they just thinned the herd. You just took it over, buddy. Nowadays, everybody has to pass to get that government money. Y'all right? I'm almost anti-government. Well, I won't go there. But let's look at this subject this morning, God's major exam. God's major exam. Nobody likes taking tests. You know, I mean, and listen, unless you know, you ever went to school knowing that you knew the stuff and was excited to take it? That never happened in my life. I never knew the stuff. Here's how I would take a test. I would do all the ones I was 100% sure about, and then I would figure out how many I had to know to pass, 70. And I'd work them out, and I'd work backwards through the answers. And when I got to my 70, well, I was okay. And then we Christmas tree the rest, you know. Happy day. Get my 70. You know, I wonder, do we do that in life? We do the things that we know, but we never really step out of our comfort zone, or we never really let God test us in other places. There's some of you here this morning, and I know this to be true because I've been one of them. There's some walking wounded in our churches that have struggled through tests. They've suffered through some quizzes that God sent, and they've struggled, and it's caused them to be angry with a person at the church, or with their preacher, with their friend, or whoever, and they've held that against them or against God for years. They've blamed everything on somebody else, and the thing is. The problem may have been, it may not have been, but the problem may have been that you just weren't ready for your test. It was test day, and you just weren't ready. And some of you failed that grade. Some of you have been hanging around in fifth grade for a long time. Some of you is going through some bigger tests. You know all that means is that you've graduated to another grade. And that God can test you and test you and test you. When I was in first grade, you know, if I could chew cornbread without choking, I'd pass first grade. You know, but when I got to be a senior, I had to know things like science is the knowledge and theory dealing with things in nature and the universe concerning forces that create, shape, and form things. Such knowledge is generally based on sound facts and reasoning obtained from experiments and careful study, thus developing factual, hypothetical, theoretical explanations and answers. You have to know stuff like that. You know, and as you get older, see, I was 1+1 in first grade, but in 12th grade, I was like 8+8. I wasn't very much better in math, but you have to get better. You see, none of the things were put on me in first grade that I couldn't handle. But as I matured, the test got harder. You with me?
Yeah.
I'm talking about in school and as a Christian. As I matured, the test got different. They took on different air. They took on different meaning, and they took on different consequences. I noticed that when I went to college, nobody cared if I passed or failed. Nobody was calling mama. Nobody was checking in. Nobody was trying to see if I was going to, is Ray okay? I think the teachers could have done their stuff without anybody in the room in college. But, you know, in high school, people would check on you. In first grade, we'd all bring soups and eat together on our mats and take naps. Remember? So you see, as a brand new Christian, the tests are one way. But as you get older, they get tougher. And the reason some of you are struggling today is you're in the middle of a test that you've been taking for a while now. And you don't know all the answers. Not sure what to do. So this morning, let's look at ways to take tests and realize that God is who He says He is. If I understand that God is the Creator God, and that without any pause, God can do anything at any time to any amount in any way He sees fit. God can sprout wings on this church, and we could fly to New York today, if he so choose. Do I think he could? If he can make an axe head float, surely he can. So when I think about the greatness of God, nothing limits God. I think today we have brought God down from the throne. We've lowered our expectations of how great God is. We've removed him from that place of high and lifted up. Because if we can get him down here, if we can get him like us, we can. Our excuses work then. Our excuses work. It's just tough. It's just the way it is. What's that? Jimmy Swaggart. Remember Jimmy Swaggart? And you remember all these preachers that failed? You remember all these? And listen, God didn't like any of those guys. But when we bring God down to our level, we think the tests are easier. You know it's a major test in your life when it doesn't make any sense at all. About that. You know it's a major test when it doesn't make any sense at all. You know, the ones that make sense, yeah, you've been there before. And you got a little experience to draw from. You know, you've come up short in your checkbook. But you know that you'll work and you'll get paid again and you'll take a little bit better care because you've been here before. Somebody hurts your feelings, but you know they're your friend and you hurt theirs sometimes. So you kind of learn how to deal with each other. But buddy, you know when it's a big test, when nothing makes sense. Listen, you're just trying to keep your head above water. God's asking you to do something, go somewhere, be something you've never been, and it doesn't make makes no sense at all. You ever been there in your lifetime? Well, I have. Hebrews 11 says, God tells Abraham to offer up Isaac. That doesn't make any sense. That doesn't make any sense. You know, and I'm going to show you something today maybe you've not seen before about this piece of scripture. And you say, boy, he just had a lot of faith that God would pull through and he wouldn't have to kill Isaac. That's how we visualize it. That's how we even preached it. I'm going to show you something else today. Take your Bibles with me. Genesis chapter 22, verse 1. Please stand with me for the reading of God's perfect word. Genesis chapter 22, verse 1 says this. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, behold, here am I. And he said, take now thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon a mountain, which I will tell thee of. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him, Isaac his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering and rose up and went into the place of God, of which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. Abraham said unto his young men, abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son, and he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. And Isaac spoke unto Abraham, his father, as they're almost going up the mountain. I can almost see it. Father, he said, here am I. Here am I, my son. And Isaac said, behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide him a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went both of them together. And they came to the place which God had told him of, and Abraham built an altar there. And he laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here am I. And he said, lay not thine hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram, offered him up for a burnt offering in the stead of his son. Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh, as it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. Lord, thank you for your word. Pray today, God, it go out with power. I pray somebody's heart be mended today. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would be seated. When I look at verses 1 and 2, there's a lot of contradictions. Verses 1 and 2 talks about some things that ought not be talked about. It talks about a father sacrificing his son. So let's look at it in a few different ways, if you would. First of all, let me read verse 1 back to you. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham. I want you to notice those three words real quick before we move on. After these things. And it came to pass after these what things? After Abraham's growth and maturity. After Abraham had gotten to a place in his life where he was ready for that test. After these things. Charles Haddon Spurgeon makes that statement. Says that God didn't put on him more than he could bear. That he'd waited till Abraham reached a place of maturity in his life. That he finally brought him to a place where he could see God. That he could understand what God wanted from him. Can I tell you this morning, God wants the same thing from you. What is that? Your undivided attention. Your undivided loyalty. And your undivided faithfulness. God wants those things from you today. How much of that do we give him? How much of that do we have you been to a place where you've been tested? First of all, let's look at the theological contradiction. You say, well, brother, what's that mean? Well, first of all, we look back and in Abraham, he said, Abraham would say, wait a minute, you made me a promise that through Isaac, all the world will be blessed. I think if you look back maybe in chapter 17, verse 19 in Genesis, you'll find where God told Isaac, or God told Abraham, that all the world through Isaac, he didn't say his son, he said Isaac, would be blessed. Generations and generations through Isaac would be blessed. Genesis chapter 17, verse 19, if you want to look. But we find there that we have a theological contradiction because if he has to kill him, then that's not true. So we have this other thing. But wait a minute, God said, put him on the altar and offer him up for a sacrifice. So we have a theological contradiction going on here. Only one thing could make this happen and make this come out to be right, and we'll talk about that in just a second. So there was a theological contradiction. Isaac's a teenager. He's not married. He has no children. And Abraham is saying, wait a minute, you said that through him, so God can't contradict himself. So something would have to happen. You see, this is where faith starts coming involved. You see, a lot of times in your life, you have to have faith that God's going to do what he said he'd do. I mean, is God speaking to you? Maybe you could come on Wednesday nights. We have a big crowd on Wednesday nights. But we're talking about how the Holy Spirit of God is speaking to people, how God is speaking to folks and giving them direction. Now, as we see here, Abraham, God had spoke to Abraham. He had told Abraham some things and promised Abraham some things. So the theological implication here is that, is God going to go back on his word? Of course not. So let's keep on going. So there's not only a theological contradiction, but a biblical contradiction. Genesis chapter 9, God condemns murder. Yet he just told Abraham to take the life of his son. That just didn't make sense, did it? How would you like to get that order? How would you like to get that order early in the morning? Let's make it easier. You wake up early and God tells you to go out there and burn your truck to the ground. That thing's taking you to places you oughtn't go. Let's say that God tells you to go get a sledgehammer and beat every TV in your house to a pulp. That thing's showing you things you ought not look at. Well, let's just say that God's trying to tell us something. Listen, there's going to be some major tests that come up in your life, or we're going to listen. And we look at them sometime, and these tests that come up, we say, God, what are you trying to show me? What are you trying to do? And Abraham here is looking at all kind of contradictions. There's also an emotional one. He says, take your son, whom you love. Abraham loves his boy. He didn't get him till he was 100. You okay? He didn't get him until he was 100 years old. Sarah was 90, 89 and 99 when they become pregnant, and 100 when he got him. So the boy's a teenager, so Abraham's somewhere 100 and something to 120 years old probably. And so he said, Lord, wait a minute. So there's an emotional attack. You're telling me to offer up my son. You're asking me to give up the thing I love the most. That's going to happen in your life before it's over with. Before you finally reach a place of maturity in your life, let me say something to you. God's going to ask you to give up some things that you love. Now, he may give them back. He may give them back when you better mature to handle those things. God may give you money back. He may give you things back. He may give you social status back. He may give you some of those things. But you better be ready to give them up. You better be ready to lay things down for because there's some folks today can't give because they owe so much. There's some folks today can't come to church because they have to work so much. Because of the things that they have. Listen, we've built this great ball of stuff. I can remember when, you know, we went to people's house on Friday night and just hung out. It didn't cost no money back in the day. You know, what we all do this week, I've been thinking about doing this over the past year or two, but what we all do is let's don't eat out for a whole week. I was going to say a month, but let's don't eat out for a whole week. And just save the money and see how much we have. See what you spend on food, the luxury. There's food. There's always food at the house, right? Anybody ever eat ketchup sandwiches? Man, I thought of a potato sandwich. Man, I thought we'd arrived. I found out the truck stop in Folkestone would make me a potato sandwich. Life was good. I didn't know that was what poor folks ate. I thought it was awesome. I remember taking my potato sandwich to school and kids having lunch meat and ham and everybody wanted my potato sandwich. You know, listen, I can remember. And they'd have them little wrapped things and this wrapped up in that. I'd have me a Debbie cake. Kids, mama sending them apples and bananas and not my mama. Mama's put some sugar in my diet, buddy. Man. But that's how it was. And we look back at things and we wonder, we want better. We want better. We want better for our kids. We want better for everybody around us. We want better for the next generation. But is it really better? Think about how much you spend a day in food eating out. And it will shock you. There's some folks here today don't spend any money eating out. None. Think of the money we waste. You see, what if God laid on your heart to take the money that you think you have to have in food and drinks, and those $5 coffees, all the luxuries, and then we get to church. I just don't have any. I don't have anything to give God. Oh, you do. You just ate it. You just drank it. I tell people, you're gonna eat yourself poor. You'll eat yourself poor. Listen. I can remember going fishing. You know, when we go fishing out, we'll stop at the swamp, go inside and get a club sandwich, some fries, put it in the boat. It may be $25. I remember when I went fishing with my daddy, we'd get a loaf of bread that was at the house and some bologna that was at the house. Lunch. That's it. Hey, and potted meat. Anybody ever grew up on potted meat? Hey, it's great when it gets hot in a boat. Amen. It's warmed up like a microwave. Imagine what you could give. Could it be that you're not growing, you're not passing these quizzes that God has for you in your life because you failed so many in the past? Man, I think we're all guilty. How about this? Before I move on, you're asking me to give up the thing I love the most is what Abraham worried about. I bet what went through his mind, he said, you're asking me to give up the very thing you blessed me with. You written that through Abraham's mind, Brother Ivy? You asking me to give up the very thing that you blessed me with. Oh, I guarantee you, I'd be ill. I'd be mad. I'd be aggravated. I'd be upset. I'd be heartbroken. There'd be a lot of things going on, a lot of emotions going on. Also, there was a relational contradiction. How am I going to explain this to my wife? The Bible says he got up and went early. Doesn't say he talked to Sarah. I bet he was going to have to try to figure out a way. You know, I don't think he thought he ever had to tell Sarah. And I'm almost to it. Thirdly, there was a spiritual contradiction. Take Isaac, slay him, and worship me. Hang on now. Take Isaac, cut his throat, and then worship me. If there was ever a day I wouldn't want to go to church, it'd be that day. Y'all right? You know what boggles my mind today? Is when people fall on hard times, they leave church. That's when they need God the most. But we're so spiritually immature today. We're all spiritual first graders because we get our feelings hurt, we get our little stuff, and we march our little tough skins out to the truck and we go home. We get mad and get on Facebook. Listen, I've had more people talk ugly about me from here on Facebook. Did it bother me? It bothered me at least. It means I'm doing my job. Brother Ray, they left. Good. They go bother somebody else. Listen, all I'm responsible for is truth. Amen. And there's going to be folks, if you preach it, listen, as you teach it and as you live it, people won't like it. That, listen, they're going to say that you're trying to be better than them. That's exactly what you ought to say. That's what I'm doing. I'm trying to be better than that. Yeah, I ain't shacking up. I ain't doing those things. I'm better than that. Oh, man, I could go on days and days. How can you worship God with a broken heart? That was what Abraham was going to have to deal with. How can I worship God with my heart broke? And really, that's what was going to happen. If he had to slay his son, then that's what would have to happen. Now, I need you to understand something here, that I don't believe that Abraham ever believed that Isaac would stay dead. Y'all with me? If you want to look in your Bible with me, Hebrews chapter 11. Abraham knew God had made him some promises. And if God had made the promises, listen, he'd seen God work in the past. And if God had him slay his son, God would bring him back from the dead. So we see the pattern started way back then. Ain't it something they showed up there to Mount Moriah on the third day? Isn't it something that he was offering, a daddy was offering his son on the third day? So we see over in Hebrews, we find, I don't believe Abraham ever believed at all that his son was going to stay dead. He didn't even tell Sarah. Imagine that coming up at supper a couple years later. Hey, Daddy, you remember that time I was at Mount Moriah and you cut my throat? Sarah, what? What about the throat? Oh, yeah, Daddy offered me up. Kill me. Yeah, kill me. I was dead as a hammer. I died. God brought me back to life. I wonder what the conversation between God the Father and God the Son was when Jesus went back to heaven. We knew I wonder if the conversation went something like, well, son, we knew what the outcome would be, but I know it was hard. I don't know if we really understand the sacrifices that were made for us to bring us to a place where we could know the peace that passes all understanding. Sometimes I don't think we understand the greatness of the God that we serve. A God that could bring somebody back, that could bring him own self back from the dead. Did I mark it in my Bible? I might not. Hebrews chapter 11. I don't want to read that to you. Maybe you got it. You want to read it to me? Chapter 11 verse 8 says this. By faith Abraham, when he was called to go into a place that he should, after receiving inheritance, obeyed and went out and by faith he sojourned in a land of promise in a strange country. And let me move around to verse 17. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 17. By faith Abraham, when he was tried, not tempted, tried, offered up Isaac. And he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. He that had received the promises, what promises? The promises that his son would be the head of a great nation. Not another son, that son. So Abraham just had to look at his son and say, God is able. God can't lie. And he left the young boys down there. People have asked about, wonder why he took Why the Bible makes the statement that they're young servants? Because they could be taught. You see, when we reach a place in life, if we're not careful, we can't be taught anymore. We reach a place that we think we know things. And he had no contradiction to what he was trying to do. Nobody ran to his aid. The boys stayed, they obeyed, they did what they were told to do. Now, when we see this, watch this. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. And he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it is said, that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from whence also, he had received him in a figure. Abraham the whole time believed that God raised him back from the dead. Hey, I'm going to kill you today. Yeah. God said you're going to be a great nation, son. How about this? There's things going on in your own lives right now. Listen, there's some struggles you're in right now, but God has been, God's faithful, and he's made you some promises. Believe him. He said he'd never leave you.
Amen.
Some of you think that God's left you. No, you've left him.
Right.
He's not left you, you've left him. He's right where he's always been, and if you're not close to him, it's your fault. Listen, get the sin out. Ask forgiveness. Come to this altar today. Say, Lord, forgive me. I'm a knucklehead. And get that stuff out. Ask God to forgive you. And then ask God to get you back on track. I promise you, if you're a child of the King and you're not where you're supposed to be, you're not happy. It's a fake smile. It's a sorrowful sleep. It's a time when you wake up in the morning. Listen, you remember what it was like when felt like the Holy Spirit of God breathed on you regularly, and the music was different, and the preaching, it was different. And every time you sat down to read God, or every time you was around God's people, boy, it just changed you. You couldn't hardly wait to get into God's house. But it was different. Look at verse 3, chapter 22, verse 3. I'm almost done. I say that. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son and clave the wood for the burnt offering, rose up and went into the palace of God, the place of which God had told him. I'm sorry, I can't read. He said, me and the boy will be back in verse 5. Abraham said to the young man, you boys stay here. Me and the boy will be back. We'll be back. Wait a minute, what was he told? What was he told? He was going to offer his son as a sacrifice, but he told him, we'll be back. We look at this right here, and we see Abraham as somebody that's sad in chapter 22, verse 1 and 2. But I'm going to tell you something. This old fellow wasn't sad. I bet he was anxious for what he was having to cause his son some pain, but he realized that in the very end, God was going to get glory. Listen, it's going to cause your children some pain when you tell them no. And a hush fell over the crowd. Listen, it's going to cause pain when they have to do it on their own. Listen, it's going to cause pain whenever they have to do it for the first time on their own. But Abraham knew that Isaac was coming back with him. He knew that he'd be better after the sacrifice. When you're called to have faith, you got to speak the truth in the midst of contradiction. Hebrews 11 says that the reason was that he knew he was coming back. Abraham had this idea, so if I obey you, God, and trust in your promise to make Isaac a good sacrifice, then I also have to behave. Abraham said, I have to behave like a Christian. God, I have to do what you called me to do. But what made him speak that? What made him believe that God could raise him from the dead? What do you think made Abraham believe that? He'd seen God do great things in the past. You see, he wasn't a young Christian anymore. He wasn't a young follower of God. He'd seen God do great things. This wasn't a quiz. This wasn't a short, small test that shows up to something that only took about 2% of your grade. This was a big test. After this, we don't see many tests from Abraham anymore. I mean, we see his life, but the Bible kind of starts moving to Isaac. I wonder why is that? I believe Abraham's life had almost been fulfilled. The work that he'd come to do, the life that he led, brought and raised the son. Could it be that the hardship that Isaac had to see on that mountain is what made him who he was? To raise up Jacob and Esau? Israel? Could it be that Abraham had to do what God told him to do in the midst of everybody going, hey man, that ain't the way to do it. That's not the way to do it. That's not the way to show that you love God. There's folks that look at you and say, you ought not go to church on Sunday nights. There's other churches don't go to church on Sunday nights. We have church on Sunday nights, if some of you are wondering. And we have a good crowd. But the reason we have church on Sunday nights is because some people have to work. And I believe that if we ever stop having church on Sunday nights, we give the devil a foothold.
That's right.
Let's just have church. Let's just have church. A man told me one time, said, how come y'all have church 3 times a week? Bible don't say you got to. I said, well, we get together for 3 times because we can't get together for 4. I mean, there's a reason why we ought to be at God. I wish we'd come every day, don't you? Wouldn't it be something if we all met here early in the morning? No, I don't like early. Late in the evenings. All eat supper together, prayed together, went home. Wouldn't it be awesome if y'all met together and sang a little bit? Went home. Listen, I believe we need more of God, not less of God. I believe we need to get to a place in our life where we can pass tests. Some of us are walking around in a daze because they were tested years ago and they didn't pass it and they're still struggling. They're still walking. They're still blaming. They're still aggravated with that old church, you know. I can't tell you how many living rooms I've sat in over the years serving God where somebody's angry with somebody else at a church they was at 25, 30 years ago. Never know, profess to be a Christian. Listen, I got news for you. You better not bank on your name being written down on a church book somewhere. You better hope your name's in the Lamb's Book of Life somewhere. Listen, if your name's in a church book somewhere, all that'll do is make you feel good, make your folks feel good at a funeral. But when your name's written in a Lamb's Book of Life, it'll make you feel good every day because you know every day God's working on you, every day God's changing you, every day God's using you, and you know you're saved because you saw God do something in your life yesterday,
amen.
Not 25 years ago. What's God doing in your life today? How's your faith? This Hebrews 11, the halls of faith, the chapter of faith, the men of faith, the warriors, the hero. Listen, hey, you're like us. You're just like us. Some of y'all had to have some great faith. I think about you, Brother Tom. The Lord's brought you through some tough days. Miss Michelle, the Lord's brought you through some tough days. Think about you guys. Brother Tracy, Lord's brought you through some tough days. You know what? Had a young couple that was a member of this church not too long ago. Got divorced. Nearly killed one of them. Nearly killed him. Here's what I told him 2 years ago. You'll be fine. You'll be fine. Crying. Brother Ray, I just can't see it. You'll be fine. Trust me. You just need a little time. You just need a little this. You keep being faithful to what you know God's called you to do. You keep being faithful to your children. You keep being faithful to your word. You keep being faithful to that book. You'll be fine.
Amen.
He couldn't see it then. I talked to him this week. He cried again. He said, Brother Ray, you're right. I couldn't see it. But you were right. He said, God is faithful.
Yes.
Family, they're not together. Not together. I wish they were. He said, God is faithful. There's some of you here today that needs to know that God's faithful. If he's promised you that he'd never leave you, he won't.
That's right.
If you're not feeling God today, if you don't feel God moving in your life today, it ain't God's fault. Listen, God has promised you, some of you, some things about ministry, and God has promised you some things about your life. God made me some promises a long time ago. He's been faithful. There's still some I'm waiting on. But see, I know what he's done in the past. I know what he's capable of. So I'm just going to wait him out. This morning, some of you in here aren't saved. You say, "Brother, how you know?" I really don't know. Every one of you may be saved. But really, what if Jesus came back today? Today. What if he came back? Would you go to heaven? You know, is the way you live your life, is the way you live your life a testimony? Is it the answer to the test? You see, I believe we ought to live a life pleasing to God. And I believe that the more mature you get in Christ, the more you understand that, man, God's watching me. I believe he sees me where I am. I don't believe there's a place I can get, a place I can be, a time, a moment that my Creator God is not right beside me.
Amen.
If you think that you're okay if you get away from here, or you're okay when you get from church and you get down the road a little ways, if you think it's okay when you get, that's a problem. Are you a Christian? Are you saved? I believe the King's coming. I believe that we're getting closer and closer to the end days. I believe that the United States was a place that God set up as the last bastion of Christianity on the face of the earth. And it's under attack.
Amen.
I believe that we are literally living in the last days. Let's don't give up now. Let's don't stop now. We've seen God in our midst do some great things. Repeat, God's going to do it. One way or the other, he's faithful. We've seen God do some great and awesome things. Are you a Christian? Have you seen God do great things, or have you heard about them? Have you seen God move, or have you heard somebody testify about God moving? Man, I've seen it. Hey, I've been to the end of my rope and quit. I've quit. Ministry, done. I couldn't love these kids and bury them. It's just too hard. Buried 7 of my youth as a youth pastor. 7. I look back and Brian, man, I was done. It's too much. It's too much. But God's faithful. God's faithful. God's faithful. He is who he says he is. And according to Ecclesiastes, if you've made him a promise, he expects you to keep it. This morning may be a time. You may have taken a big test. You might be in the middle of one. These wounded warriors that are walking around, get in. Listen. Find you a church. Find you a spot and dig in. Dig in. Go to work. Don't let church be something you do when you don't have anything else to do. Well, the devil loves that. Just go and get in. Go and dig you a spot and waller it out and dare anybody to touch it. This is where God sent me. I'll be right here till he comes. What a blessing. Let's pray. Lord, you are good, and your mercy truly does endure forever. Lord, there's people here this morning that have been hurt and are upset, angry, and rightly so. Lord, there's folks here that went through some tough days, some tests in life, and they didn't do very good. And they wonder what's now, what's next. Lord, I don't doubt at all that you'd have us sit back in our seat and learn again from the Master, to grow again and try to love again, try to have faith again, try to grow again. Help us, God, to love each other, pray for each other, welcome each other, be involved in each other's lives. But God, I pray most of all today for that one who's here that's lost, that's never asked you to forgive their sins, to never, you don't have, they're not in your heart, you're not in their heart, Lord. And I pray that today be a day that they pass that test. The Holy Spirit's calling them. The devil wouldn't do that. The devil wouldn't have them come and get saved, but God, you would. So God, I pray for that person who's struggling today. Pray you help them through. I pray for that person who needs peace today. Pray, Lord, you give them strength. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would, please stand. If you need to come, please do. If you need to come, please do. Today's your day. It's your test. You know what God's told you. Go and get up early. You know what God's called you to do. Go and get up early. Go on down and do what God's called you to do. Don't wait. Don't wait. God's been so good. God's been so good. You got here today. You got here today. Somewhere there's a family that didn't make it to church. We come this morning. There's a wrecker sitting side the road in a car out in the woods. Where they was going. But God blessed me to make it to church today. God blessed me to get down to his house. God's blessed me to see some of the things that I've seen. And he blessed me to go catch 5 fish yesterday. Well, 3 fish. 6 fish. I caught 3. I don't know how many of them I caught. But God blesses us. We think sometimes those things are owed us. God don't owe me nothing. Listen, he give me salvation. No matter how bad this life is, when it's all said and done, I'm going to be in glory. No matter how bad things are here, Brother Tracy, no matter how tough they are here, God is still who he says he is. God's good. Anybody have anything to say? Before we dismiss, Brother Ethan wanted me to tell you for our church softball team, and if there's anybody else, see Brother Ethan, but we need need to get on a list, a phone list, all the numbers and make a little group. But need your money for your jersey and your spot to play by Wednesday. I think it's $25 or $40, something like that. So, and the teenagers can play if they got a parent's signature. So Hank's in. Hank was on one more play. He was hurt when he heard it was just for adults. But anyway, anybody have anything to say before we dismiss? If not, Brother Albert, would you dismiss us?